Thank you, Tom. Can you all hear me okay? Great to be here in Pittsburgh. It's a bit early in the morning, but that's okay. I'm going to wander around some. Feel free to do the same yourself. And I'm at least 6 feet away, and I'll try not to spit, okay? All right, impact of rapid whole genome sequencing on morbidity and mortality in children in intensive care units. There's my slide overview, some background, a case example similar to Tom's. Then we'll look at the evidence to date, and we'll look at implementation across North America. And then, provided we got time and I'm not too long-winded, we'll get into where this is going to go over the next 5 to 10 years. Does that sound good? I could tell jokes instead if you wanted me to. Okay, background. So, Tom, I'm sorry, I'm going to disagree with you. There are 6,200, not 3,500, known genetic diseases as of online Mendelian inheritance in man. If you're a Klin Jenner, you might actually like Tom's number better, but I'm an OMIM guy, so I'm going to go with 6,200. And that number changes every night. And why this is relevant to neonatal care is that if you have a kid with something like neurodevelopmental disabilities or seizures, you are confronted with a differential diagnosis list which is completely overwhelming. And as Tom pointed out, many of these conditions you'll never have encountered in your NICU practice, even after decades. So the beautiful thing about a genome is that it's one test that allows you to examine the vast majority of these simultaneously. And yes, panel tests can look at some, and exomes can look at nearly all, but genomes have the ability to look at the full spectrum of mutation sets or variant sets, as well as most of the genome. So, beautiful test. The issue has just been getting everything in place to be able to offer that in a timely manner to critically ill newborns. Now, the other thing which Tom said was, and I was really paying attention, was he had an incidence of 5% in NICU populations of genetic diseases. I'd suggest it's more like 30%. And let me see if I can back that up. So we're doing a project right now where we are looking through San Diego infant mortality over a 5 or 7 year period. So we're just redoing all of those newborn blood spots for babies who died and saying, why did they die? And their death certificate records a cause of death. And that's shown on that top Venn diagram, the death certificate results. So we decoded the genomes of all of these babies, and 41% of them actually had underpinning genetic diseases. So the death certificates were wrong. This is the true nature of genetic disease in infancy, is we massively underdiagnose genetic conditions. And in this case, tragically, many of these kids never were diagnosed prior to death, and a number of those kids had treatable conditions. So we want to solve this, okay? We want to solve this issue that we are massively underdiagnosing genetic disease, even at great institutions with available genetic tests, and then getting those kids onto appropriate therapies. So I'm old, so I remember the 70s and the 80s. These days we're in the 2010 section, where we now believe in genome-informed healthcare delivery. And for genetic disease, it's a must, right? You just have to have that. For other areas of healthcare delivery, maybe a genome isn't on your must-have list, but for genetic diseases, it has to be there. We can't give optimal therapy without knowing the underpinning cause of a disease. It's just not good enough today to say you have seizure disorder and apply a clinical syndrome name to it, like Lennox-Gastaut. We gotta know what's the underpinning molecular cause to give you the optimal treatment. Now, what's coming in 10 years or so will be that that's not enough either, and that instead, within every condition, we'll have trajectories that are known, biomarkers. We'll know more beyond just the diagnostic label. We'll know the mechanism of action of the causative variant. So to show this paradigm in a little bit more detail, I'm going to refer to something called INSIGHT. This was an NIH-funded grant that's now finished, and we've published the results in these three manuscripts. So we enrolled 213 infants from the intensive care units in Rady Children's Hospital. So this was NICU, PICU, and CVICU, but they're all infants. So they're critically ill. And the only caveat why you couldn't be enrolled in this study was if we knew the etiology of your condition. So if you had hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy after a clear-cut anoxic incident, we didn't sequence you. If you had an infectious illness and we knew the agent, we didn't enroll you. But about half of our NICU were eligible for this, and this is where that incidence calculation comes in. So we wanted to do genome sequencing immediately, so you could only be enrolled within 96 hours of admission, and we also required that we would get a copy of the medical record for artificial intelligence. So you received then an empiric treatment while we waited for the results. Between 12 and 46% of the kids, we made a diagnosis of a genetic disease, overall representing about 12% of NICU admissions during the interval. Now, the real point of this study was not to look at diagnostic rates, because that's well documented, and it averages about 1 in 3. It was more to look at clinical utility, both in the eyes of MDs and also in the eyes of parents. When we started this study, there was a lot of fear, a lot of ethical fear and social fear in terms of could parents cope with genome information during a crisis, the crisis of having a baby in an intensive care unit situation. And most of our fears were ill-founded in this regard, in that we found that parents did not suffer anxiety, decisional regret, despair, depression, and so on. We found that this information was perceived to be useful by parents and assisted in communication with the healthcare delivery team. Those are positive results. We've made a diagnosis of a genetic disease. What was more surprising, though, was the impact of negative results. And this is because we're decoding a genome. When we decode a genome, we actually are able to look at loci of interest and say there isn't a variant in there that we know to be pathogenic. We can't absolutely rule out a condition, but we can certainly change the posterior probability that the child has PKU, for example, because we are able to systematically look across the introns, exons, and upstream and downstream of the gene and say, I don't see anything there. And so physicians, not surprisingly, found that negative reports had clinical utility, that in many cases they were concerned about treatable conditions on the differential diagnosis that they didn't want to miss, or alternatively, they were focused on a genetic etiology and this allowed them to move on and look at a different type of etiology. And surprisingly, was that 16% change in management with a negative result and an 8% change in outcome. That's something that requires a lot more study because it shows a whole different side of genome sequencing in terms of the utility of a negative test in a symptomatic child. Parents were much more black and white. They just thought genomes were great either way. If we went back to parents and said, your child appears to have a healthy genome, we don't find any cause for your child's illness in the genome, they thought this was fantastic. So that's the paradigm, okay? That's what we're trying to implement as standard of care across North America. In order to do that, we have to be sure that this is accurate information. The world that we're entering into is really illustrated powerfully by Duchenne muscular dystrophy. So this, in boys, is the commonest cause of muscle weakness. Hitherto, it was just a progressive muscle disorder, onset of symptoms roughly about age 3, and death in late teens, 20s, of progressive muscle failure, you know, inability to breathe adequately, cardiomyopathy. But now we're in an era where the mutation that you have defines which therapy you'll get, which allele-specific oligonucleotide you'll be given to make a mini dystrophin and overcome disease progression. And this is the future. This is the future that we're looking forward to, where we're focused not just on a diagnosis, but also what's the variant, what's the mechanism of action, and how do we give targeted treatment to arrest the progression of disease. It's super exciting. And we really are at an inflection point. Let's look at these three lines together. The black line is the cost of decoding a genome. And this is from NHGRI's information, so we're talking about a research genome, 30-fold coverage. We're not talking about CLIA-CAP or interpretation. But these days, it costs about $650 to decode a human genome. That means that we're entering an era where we'll have abundant genome sequences in healthcare delivery. And you can see that's an exponential decay curve. It's not slowing down much, and so we can anticipate that in the next 5 years, it will be $100 for a research genome, opening up a vast array of clinical applications. The blue line I'm partly responsible for, and when I say I mean the guys and gals who work at our institute and previous to this in Kansas City, because together we were able to attack the problem of getting a result in time for a critically ill infant. Now, Tom didn't talk about this, but one of the unique things about pediatrics and one of the unique things about neonatology is how fast disease evolves, right? In adults, you've got days typically to get it right. Disease progression in adults is fairly slow, with a few dramatic exceptions. But by and large, disease progression is slow. When it comes to pediatrics, you blink and the kid's condition has progressed. When it comes to newborns, it's a tenth of a blink. It's scary. It's why I didn't go into neonatology. It's scary how fast these kids get sick. So they need answers immediately. And what I'll show you is how we can decode and interpret a genome in 13 and a half hours. So same day results. And that's the future. The future is same day genome information as part and parcel of your medical record. So as quickly as you can get an MRI or an echocardiogram result, you'll be able to get a genome result. And then the last line is really the driver line here, and that is genetic therapies. That whether you know it or not, over the next 10 years, we're going to have a tsunami of genetic therapies. Just as we now have three or four for Duchenne muscular dystrophy, we can anticipate that hundreds of genetic diseases will be tractable with thousands of different molecular entities. And that's what's going to drive this. Up until now, we haven't had highly effective or curative therapies for many of these conditions. In the future, we will, and that's what's going to drive early diagnosis. Case example. So this was in the New England Journal a couple of months ago. It's a beautiful case. This little boy who appeared in our emergency department at about 11 p.m., I believe it was a Sunday night, brought by his mum with a seemingly innocent complaint, which was she couldn't get her child to settle. But nurses in EDs recognize when it's, you know, a new parent versus, oh, this child is ill. And this child clearly was encephalopathic, that this was not regular irritability. This child actually had brain irritation and also had subtle but definite neurologic findings on exam. Mom and dad were first generation Americans, but like myself, consanguineous, not like myself. Part of the reason I had to move to America was I grew up Protestant, my wife grew up Catholic, and that didn't work in Northern Ireland. So the baby's admitted, this is what happens when you get too little sleep. You spontaneously digress. Maybe you'll like that and maybe you won't, I don't know. So presented at 11 p.m., gets a stat head CT scan, computed axial tomography of the brain, and admitted to the NICU. And A through C show the, this is actually an MRI, not a CT scan, but show the findings in the child. And those white lesions look like what I mentioned earlier, hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy, but there was no anoxic incident. It was a normal pregnancy, it was a normal delivery. This child doesn't have HIE, they have something which is resembling that, something that's mimicking that. This vividly illustrates the problem for a neonatologist. This looks like a common condition which has its own treatment, and if you'd given that child the treatment for HIE, the child would have died. It's the wrong treatment for this case. But it looks exactly like it, and that's the common cause. Instead, there are metabolic conditions that can mimic this. Now, in morning rounds, both parents are present, and we get more family history, and it turns out that 10 years ago, an older sibling, a sister, died in our ICU, presented at the same age to the same ED in the pre-genomic era. So that baby looked like HIE, treated like HIE, and tragically just had a rapid progressive encephalopathy and died of seizures and progressive encephalopathy after a year. And the sister's MRI was also in our system, and DNA show that. And you can see they look almost identical with these white lesions. So we're now very concerned about a recessive cause of this child's condition, and so we want to get a genome. So in our system, this is now normative, and we have a button in our EHR for rapid whole genome sequencing. We have a discussion because this baby is one of the subset in whom we need an ultra rapid genome. So we have two speeds, we get rapid and ultra rapid. And this baby is of the type where hours matter, and we want to get this as quickly as possible. So by 5 p.m. that afternoon, we have consented mom and dad, we've obtained a blood sample, and we've brought it over to the genome center. And this is where we get into the excitement, because this is a new method that allows us to decode a genome in 13 hours. So sample prep starts. We go straight from blood to library. We get that on the sequencer, as you can see, at about 7:30 in the evening. We're running the sequencer on steroids, so we sped up the machine so its cycle time is faster, and we're running what we call an SP flow cell, which means that the sequencing is done in about 11 hours. We've then sped up the analysis of the genome, and we're using AI. And so the AI tool takes all the variants, about 6 million variants, and figures out their pathogenicity using accepted criteria and their gene and disorder connections. And then on the other hand, it takes the EHR and extracts all the clinical phenotypes, pattern recognizes those against the 6,200 genetic diseases, and then marries those two inputs to drive a differential diagnosis. And in this case, we have a single diagnosis, which is, as listed there, autosomal recessive biotin thiamine responsive basal ganglia disease. So it's a defect in a thiamine transporter in the brain. Baby can't deliver thiamine intracellularly, and the baby is homozygous for that. So mom and dad are carriers, and baby is a homozygous affected. So we report that back at 8:23 a.m. So just think about this, 11 p.m. or 3 hours earlier, onset of irritability, and now a day later, we have the cause of the illness. Now in the interim, the baby had indeed progressed to seizures on electroencephalogram, so the baby's condition was deteriorating rapidly. Now the good news is this is treatable with biotin and thiamine in large doses. So we get the pills, we crush them up, and we administer them through an NG tube since the baby's not feeding. And within 6 hours, a miracle has occurred. The baby is tranquil, alert, bottle feeding, and the encephalopathy has gone. Baby stopped seizing, never seizes again, goes home after a couple of days, and that occurred back roughly October of last year, and the baby is healthy. So compare the sibling 10 years ago without a genome, and her younger brother now in the genome era. This is what we want to democratize across NICUs all around the first world. So we've been doing this for 10 years, so that top date is 2012, where we did the first 4 NICU infants. And now you can see the world's literature has 23 studies listed there, a total of 1838 babies. These are in different healthcare systems. These are different tests, rapid exome, rapid genome, and different indications for inclusion and exclusion. But the overall results are highly congruent, which is that about a third of babies will get a diagnosis, and about 80% of those diagnoses, 90% of those diagnoses, will change the acute management of the child's condition. This may not seem amazing to you, but it is. If you've been in healthcare, you'll know that it's not every day that you have an intervention that does this, cross-cutting across multiple different disorders. This is going to be one of the larger revolutions ever to occur in neonatology. So where are we at in terms of implementation worldwide? Well, England and Wales have now implemented a national healthcare delivery system. So in 2018, the Secretary of Health made this policy for the National Health Service. Wales' system has been implemented for about a year and a half. England had a setback in that COVID came along and it's delayed implementation, but they're setting that up now currently. So inpatient infants and children are eligible for what I've just shown you across the UK. The same has happened in Australia. They started out with rapid exome sequencing. They've now converted to rapid genome sequencing, and they're also at implementation. In the US, we're doing okay. We started it here, but our system is very fragmented, as you know, in terms of policy determination and payors. And so we now have 72 hospitals across 26 states who are sending us samples for our center to decode the genomes. And they're shown in the colors there. You can see the geographic distribution. But I want to talk about Project Baby Bear and Baby Deer, which are Medicaid pilot projects, which really show the future in the US. So Baby Bear was $2 million in legislatively authorized funds to prove out what I showed you, but to prove it out in the real world. So not in a research setting, not with consent and IRB protocol and all of the accessories that come with that, project managers and so on. But actually to do this in the real world for Medicaid infants in five children's hospitals that cover the geographic and ethnic diversity of California. So Valley Children's, for example, is in a, it's just a massive agricultural area, whereas some of the other centers obviously are very urbanized. So we enrolled 178 babies across those five centers. The overall diagnosis rate was the same as we had seen in research studies. So doing this in the real world didn't affect the diagnosis rate. Our uptake was very high. It was over 80% of approached families who agreed to have their baby's genome decoded. And the proportion with a change in management as a result of the diagnosis was also very much similar to the published studies. But this had a second arm, this study, which was to look at the impact on Medicaid cost. And we had believed that this would be net zero cost to the system because it allows more efficient delivery of care, more effective utilization of resources. But what we actually found was that it was net cost saving. And as you can see there on a sensitivity analysis, it depends very much how fast you turn the result around as to how much cost savings there was. And in addition to the hospitalization savings, there are other types of savings that are tougher to quantify and should continue to accrue across the lifespan. And so the net savings across all three types will be more than what we published recently in the American Journal of Human Genetics. But the bottom line is this saves Medicaid money. So not only does it improve outcomes, but it has a negative cost of implementation. So in terms of what that means for you and your local NICU, that's still evolving. So Anthem Blue Cross Blue Shield covers this across the US, but that still has to be ratified by each individual state plan and then negotiated hospital by hospital in your Blue Cross Blue Shield policy. So it's still taking time to be implemented. Furthermore, if you're a NICU director, having a fraction of your children have it as part of their plan doesn't really work. It's not like you can just offer that to Blue Cross Blue Shield beneficiaries. So we really need big systems in addition to Blue Cross Blue Shield to come along so that in aggregate, the majority of patients are covered. Now the policy itself is excellent. It's shown on the right, you can look it up. It's a really well thought through policy with the right indications for testing. But excitingly, Project Baby Bear resulted in legislation, and it's now law in California, that rapid genome sequencing be available for infants in intensive care units. That's not yet resulted in a Medicaid policy. That will happen. It's going to take, we hear, about 6 months. But Michigan beat California because Project Baby Deer was ongoing, and Michigan decided, let's just beat California. And so they just wrote a policy as opposed to going through all of that legislative activity. And so as of September 1st, this is now a covered benefit for Michigan babies. And September 1st, we had our first babies samples sent from Bronson NICU in Michigan. So good for Michigan. I want to come back. I've got a couple more minutes, so I want to look into the future, okay? Just accept that what I told you is going to happen. It's going to be normative. We've got a great amount to do. So let's look at the future together. So one of the most startling genetic therapies to be come available in the, ever, well, in the last 5 years, is Zolgensma for spinal muscular atrophy. So hitherto, if your baby was floppy at birth, one of the leading differentials was spinal muscular atrophy type 1, and hitherto that was a death diagnosis. Babies died by age 2. But now with gene therapy, or gene replacement, either gene rescue or gene replacement, we can prevent disease progression. So the tragedy about this is the length of time that it goes from FDA approval to actually having that be routinely available to babies who need it. Because we still have all of the other impediments, like how do we get this on the newborn screen? How do we get states to actually then recognize that it's on the newborn screening panel? How do we then implement that in hospitals? How do we get approval for the drug itself? And how do we all deliver this in a way that preserves anterior horn cells, which are dying by the day? So really we need to look at this not as a test, but rather as a healthcare delivery system. And we've taken a lot of the clues to building this from newborn screening itself. So newborn screening is a healthcare delivery system that's very effective for these inborn errors of metabolism. So we're copying this now for NICU implementation of rapid whole genome sequencing. The top line's all about getting the NICU team and the hospital ready to do this. And that's a lot of training and education, a lot of stakeholder engagement. So both Jerry and Tom are like our key stakeholders at UPMC in delivering this. And then we have the actual testing piece, which we're doing. But then there's this awesome bottom line where if we do this right, we build out longitudinal real-world history studies, real-world evidence, natural history studies of disease that will accelerate drug development for drugs like Zolgensma. So we are working on a piece of this that I want to just speak about for a second. It'll be a few more bits than a second, but not much more. And that's something called GTRX. GTRX is genome to treatment, and this is a system to allow a frontline neonatologist to resemble an expert subspecialist in that condition. It turns out the world's literature for the vast majority of these diseases is poorly organized and is largely comprised of case reports and case studies. So what we've done is to use AI tools and then expert curation to build an authoritative web-based resource that we intend to hook into the diagnostic report so that we won't leave the poor neonatologist with a semi-intelligible written report of variant information and its pathogenicity. Will also empower them with tools to translate that into treatments. And this just gives an overview of the first 100 genes that we reviewed. And you can see the number of interventions and literature pieces of evidence that we had to review just for 100 conditions. So this is not ready for a frontline neonatologist. Who in the world can go to the world's literature and do a web search when you have a diagnosis of a condition you're not familiar with? So let's just look at one example. This is Timothy syndrome. This is a calcium channel defect that causes sudden infant death syndrome. So malignant dysrhythmias. The first-line treatment is propranolol. You should start that immediately upon diagnosis, or more likely esmolol, which is an IV version of that. And then the secondary treatment is mixolydine, and you go all the way then through AICD implantation if need be. So this is just one example of what GTRX shows you. So I'm out of time, so I'm going to skip this slide, and we're going to go to the summary. So rapid phenome-assisted genome sequencing is increasingly being implemented for acute management guidance for inpatient infants with diseases of unknown etiology, and I've reviewed the impact. And the innovation piece is that a world of new evolving genetic therapies is going to drive this field, and we're going to have this beautiful mix of rapid testing and rapid diagnosis and rapid development of genetic therapies. And as COVID has shown us, we can now develop genetic therapies in less than a year. Adeo lumen ab amicis auxilium means to God for creativity, to friends for help. And these are the people who have done this work. And these are the folk who actually did the work I presented today, which is unpublished. Thank you very much.